The Ministry of Secondary Education has developed a distance learning platform for students of secondary education in Cameroon. A series of lessons taught by qualified teachers for secondary school students. Under the stewardship of Professor Pauline Nalovalyonga in collaboration with the Ministry of Posts and Telecommunications, CAMTEL, CRTV, and UNESCO, we are introducing distance learning as another teaching and learning method which is different from the traditional classroom setting that you are all used to. In the distance education mode, you are not with the teacher in person, so take your time, relax, listen to the teacher, take down notes and visit the following links for any questions or answers to your questions. Take it in your stride. This is Cameroon's solution to COVID-19 and beyond. Professor Nalovalyonga, Minister of Secondary Education.
Welcome to your distance learning session with me, Jilaino Steve, your history teacher at Lowasi Dance. Correction of homework. You are given homework. Now we are going to do the correction. We are to carry out an inquiry into any 19th century grassland kingdoms to justify the fact that before the advent of colonization, Cameroon was civilized. The response to our homework, we have the following. You are going to define civilization. Cameroon was a civilized state. Cameroon was made up of civilized states and a civilized nation, made up of different kingdoms as well as fundums. It was a civilized state, had civilized state because Cameroon had gone through migration that resulted into settlement and into state and kingdoms. Many states and kingdoms emerged in the modern day Cameroon. Before colonization, Cameroon was a German creation. Thus, there existed state and kingdoms before colonization. And these state and kingdoms were well organized. They were well governed and civilized, contrary to the conception that Europeans had that Cameroon, in particular, was anarchical, was disorganized. This is to discard the Eurocentric views that Cameroon had a civilization well structured with leaders, with funds, with kings that rule or govern the states and kingdoms. That is not different from what we have today in our modern Cameroon. Responding to our question above, our homework, these states and kingdoms were well organized. They were made up of centralized and decentralized, or acephalous states. Centralized states were mostly found in the Western grass field, as well as in the northern part of the country. In the northern part of the country, the jihad has installed powerful traditional rulers, which were made up of Ado, Lamido, among others, with a lot of authority in their hands that command the authority than the ability of the people and their respect, as well as in the Western grass field, where we have the forms that had all powers in their hands, and they ruled the people with a lot of organization, peace, and stability. Also, these states existed as independent chiefdoms, which means with their various leaders leading their territories and commanding the authority with rules and regulations governing the people. The pre-colonial society, states and kingdoms in Cameroon had a history on a territory. Today we are going to look at lesson 7. Lesson 7 is based on the political, social, and economic organization of the Nso Patrilineal Kingdom. Nso is one of the biggest patrilineal kingdoms in the northwest region of Cameroon, ruled by Fons. This fundum was made up of well-established leaders, well-organized social institutions, well-governed economic activities, under the leader of the Nso community. The political set of Nso had checks and balances, contrary to what the Europeans believe, that our territory, especially the Nso land, was not organized. Our lesson plan that we're going to follow for today, we are going to learn Our learning plan will be as follows. The first, we are going to look at the learning objectives of this lesson. Secondly, we are going to look at the previous knowledge, what was given to you. Again, the situation in real life, what we face today in our real life, and how, what has to be done to make sure that we re-establish our pre-colonial institutions. Also, the learning activities will be examined. Again, application exercise will be given to you, and we'll end with assignment. Let's look at our lesson objectives. We are going to trace the origin of the Nso community. We are going to examine the political, social, and economic organization of the Nso patrilinear pre-colonial kingdom. In our previous knowledge, you have learned about the various ethnic groups that existed in Cameroon today, like the Bantus, the Semi-Bantus. Bantu or Semi-Bantu is linguistic appellation. It refers to a group of people with similar characteristics in terms of language, like the Bantu, which mostly occupy the forest region or the equatorial rainforest of Cameroon, and the Semi-Bantu, the western grass field. Remember, we have the Sudanese or the Fulbe that occupy the northern part of the territory. This is linguistic classification. Today, Cameroon is unity in diversity with more than 240 tribes. According to Professor Willy Brodzengwa, there are more than 250 ethnic groups in Cameroon with different cultural backgrounds and language, adding to the two colonial languages, which is two official languages in Cameroon, English and French, has made Cameroon a diverse cultural nation. That is, we are united in diverse cultural backgrounds or tribes. Our situation problem will be taken from this picture. Observe the picture a minute, and the source we got this picture from www.researchgate.net. We are going to answer the following questions. What does it represent? You look at the picture carefully. What does it represent? Again, what was her name? The picture represents a female. What was her name? Also, do you know where can we find this picture? What is in the document? Most of us don't know where this document can be found, or what is in the document can be found. Even the Nso people, some of the Nso people, and most people in Cameroon at large, don't know where we can get this document, the image in the document. Do you know where it can be found? That is the question that preoccupies our mind. That has led us to the situation problem, which is non-attachment to our history. It is true that nowadays the Eurocentrist ideologies have eaten up our society. It's a cankerworm in our society. People don't believe in tradition. People don't go back to their traditional heritage to learn more. People behave in a different way from our cultural activities. We don't longer dress again in our traditional style. We don't know how to speak our dialects. We don't know how to eat our traditional meal. We don't go back to the village to gain more about our culture, to re-establish what has been destroyed from the influence of colonization. What can be done to enkindle your interest in the history of pre-colonial Cameroon? What can be done to enkindle your interest in the history of pre-colonial Cameroon? Furthermore, how can you harness potentials to participate in the cultural festivals as well as the leadership of your village community? We have everything at our disposal. How can we use these potentials to restitute, to make sure that we become leaders in our community, to participate in our cultural festival? It is true that our cultural festival, in most cases, have been neglected, and we need to restore them and restore the history and civilization we had before colonization. From the situation problem, we are going to use this to answer our problems, the question raised above. We have to mobilize resources to carry out inquiry on the legacies of pre-colonial Cameroon. Pre-colonial Cameroon had legacies that when annexed with the resources we have, we are going to restitute the history and civilization of Cameroon in particular, especially the Nsoh community. We have to promote the practice of national culture and languages within our school milieu or within your school milieu. In our school milieu, we need to promote our language. We need to promote our culture. It is true. And thanks to the government of Cameroon, the Ministry of Culture has been put in place that will actually play a greater role to revamp the culture or the pre-colonial heritage or legacies that Cameroon had, which was rich. You will have to participate in your cultural festival and future leaders of the village community. Most of you are leaders in your communities, but how do you harness the resources to make sure that you become the best leader? We need to go back to our culture. Lesson activity for today. We are going to observe the document for 1 minute and answer the following questions. The source of the document was from a library owned by Vicky Jiga Fanso, Professor Vicky Jiga Fanso. We can observe the picture, the attire. Next, we look at the traditional activity. Who are those personalities from the picture observed? Let's answer the following questions. Who are those personalities? Again, what is the significance of the events they are attending? This will lead us to possible response as seen below. The document is a picture that demonstrates the coronation of the present form of Nsoh Kingdom, Sembinglo the First. Remember, the Nsoh community have a common historical link with the Bamun community. In the document, we are able to see the coronation of the throne of Nsoh and the presence of the Bamun Sultan. It showed the historical relation. They originated from Rifim, Adamawa region, and they had to separate due to dynastic feud. That is why during coronation of the throne in Solan, you have the link with the Bamun that they have a representative. This will lead us to exercise 2, using elements from the document, construct an appropriate definition of patrilineal kingdom. From the definition of patrilineal kingdom, it was defined as succession to the throne by the son over the father. Succession to the throne by the son over the father to the throne. We can see the relationship here, the patrilineal succession. We see the son, we see the father. A possible response, continuation of our possible response. The document we have seen above is a picture that demonstrates the coronation of the present form of Nsoh, from Sembinglo the First. Also, it showcases the ancestral relationship between the fundum, the kingdom of Nsoh and the Sultanate of Bamun, as highlighted above. That Nsoh has a similar history with the Bamun community. Exercise 2, using the element from the document, construct an appropriate definition of patrilineal kingdom. The definition of patrilineal kingdom are many and varied. There are different schools of thought that have advanced different definitions, but according to the Oxford Advanced Learner's Dictionary, it denotes the relationship between father and child that continues in a family with each generation. Thus, the child, especially the male child, take over the father and it continues from generation to generation. This is termed patrilinear succession. Then, some community in particular is a patrilinear society or tribe. In that society, inheritance of land is patrilinear. In addition, succession in patrilinear was especially given or privileged to the male child and not the female child. Now we are going to look at the origin of the insult according to Vicky Gigafanso. Professor Vicky Gigafanso has given a vivid historical origin of the Nsor community. According to him, the Nsor people originated from Rhythm. Rhythm in the Adamawa region. It is noted that Ngonso, who was a female, had two brothers, Ncharigen and Mbanyen. After a succession squabble that arose after the death of their father, the children had to fight over succession. Unfortunately, none could not succeed the father. It led to separation. Thus, Ngonso and the brother Ncharigen and Mbanyen separated at a river crossing. Due to leadership squabbles, Ncharigen went to found the Bamun and Mbanyen founded Bafia. It is said that Ncharigen left Rhythm, passing through River Mban, temporary settlement at Njimom. From Njimom, he further moved south and arrived at Mfumben, where he met the Ndobo. That is, the Bamlege people chased them to the upper side of the Nile and settled at Mfumben that we have today, with the first founder, Ncharigen. And so, went west and briefly settled at Mbonso and Jinso before arriving Kovifum. At Kovifum, which is now northeast of Kimbok, presently the capital of the original settlers, the aborigines, were subdued, that is, they were subjugated by the Nsor people. And their settlement led to expansion of the fundum. The expansion spanned from Kovifum beyond Nka in the south to Kimbok in the Shisong. In the course of expansion, they attacked on seven Noni villages. And these seven Noni villages included Yabdin, Dom, Jotin, Noni, Lasin, Mbinong, and Nko. The settlement led to the emergence of new Nso language, which was known as Lamso today. From the origin of the Nso, we are going to look at the political organization of Nso fundum in the pre-colonial period. We are going to use this document to express the prowess of Fon of Nso. This document was extracted from Fanso's library. From the document, we have observed the leadership prowess of Fonso. The Fon of Nso was a benevolent monarch. That is, he ruled according to the wishes of the people. He danced according to the tune of the people. He had the powers, manifestation of supernatural powers, was seen as a divine leader. That is, the people look at him to be God representative on earth. That's why his decisions were final. The people loved and respected the authority of the Fon of Nso. In the document, you can observe one of the notables. interacting with the Son of Himself in a respectful and traditional way. It shows the Son of Himself as a powerful traditional leader, a centralized traditional authority, a leader that could command the authority of the people, just like our modern states today. The Son of Himself remained the power, the authority, and the commander of the land of Himself. He owned the land and can even banish any recalcitrant case or person in the land that goes against tradition or cause harm to the tradition. The Son of Himself, as earlier said, was a benevolent monarch, possessed divine powers. That is, the people saw him as God's representative on earth. He manifests supernatural powers. The Son of Himself was a God and the highest priest of the land. He was the custodian of land and culture. The link between the living and the dead was in the hands of the Son of Himself. He communicated with the ancestors and could declare war or maintain peace. But it is important to note that in the pre-colonial Himself, there were checks and balances. The Son could be dethroned or impeached when goes against tradition by the regulatory societies. Again, the link between the living and the dead, the symbol of unity of the land, was in the hands of the Himself Son. Now we are going to look at some political institutions in the pre-colonial Himself and the duties of these pre-colonial institutions. We are going to begin with Mwerong. Mwerong was a regulatory society with judicial powers. That is, it could administer justice and it could carry out decisions taken by the Son. Again, we have the Ngiri. It was a lodge that was made up of the princes and the princesses. But today the princes have outsmarted the princesses in Ngiri. Coupled with that, we have the Manjong. The Manjong was a military wing charged with responsibility of defense and security. It is true that the Manjong in any society, even in Cameroon today, we have the military wing that maintained peace and order, the police force. In the pre-colonial Himself, this institution existed, not different from what we have today. The Manjong maintained peace, carried out territorial expansion, and execute decisions of the Son. The Manjong remained a powerful military wing in Himself that maintained peace and order, tranquility and stability that made Himself society to progress and be more civilized. Coupled with that, we have the Vibai. The Vibai was the counselor or and the lineage. The counselors and lineage. Lineage had control that control large areas of land. That is, counselors and lineage had that control large areas of land in the Himself land. They assisted the Son in administration through advice and report any cases in Himself land to the Son. Thus, they remain auxiliaries of the Son in the Himself land. Leaving the political institution or establishment or set up on Himself land in the pre-colonial period, we are moving to the social setup of Himself Fondom. Socially, we have the Wonto. The Wonto were the first group of people. That is, they were the children of the Son. They had special status in the society. Coupled with that, we had the second group of people of the Wonto, which were the palace retainers or pages, that is those in the palace that were responsible of keeping the palace functioning. Again, we have the Dui. The Dui. The Dui was made up of sons of the previous sons. They had privileges, but could never aspire to become kings in Himself Fondom. And we have the Nta. In any society, in the course of migration and settlement, most any group met settlers where they are found today. The Himself people met the Nta. That's the descendants of men who Himself met on the spot after the migration into the region. Denta were expected to supply royal wives, and the royal wives were carefully selected by the Nta, which occupied a very important society in the Nso land. Away from social organization of the Nso Kingdom, we have the economic setup. The economic organization in any society remains one of the most important activities. In Nso land, agriculture remains the main economic life wire. Cultivation in Nso land, though rudimentary, but they cultivated food crops like corn, guinea corn, finger millet, and root crops. That notwithstanding, other crops like kola nuts, especially for export, by the Nso people were equally cultivated. And the raffia palm were cash crops equally cultivated. Also, animal rearing was not left out in Nso Kingdom, as they included herd of sheep, goats, and fowls. Sheep, goats, fowls had important role in the Nso tradition, especially during marriage, during initiation into some cultural, some traditional institutions, these animals are needed. Coupled with this, there was craft work in Nso land. They were very good in craft work, and they fabricated fiber bags, which we have today, weaving baskets, carving of stones, and statues, among others. Application exercise one. You look at the picture carefully in a minute. This picture was taken from Grand Princess Adeline Mbengun. We are going to look at the questions that follow the image above. Describe the woman in the document. With inspiration from the document, which legacy in the pre-colonial Nso can you showcase to the modern world? Let's go back to the image. From the image, it is obvious that the princess were not, that is, they were special. And it is clear that the wives of the fawns were carefully selected. When you look at the princess, the way she dressed in the traditional regalia, it now depicts or presents the culture, the rich cultural heritage that we have in the Nso land. It shows the lively culture, the lovely culture. It showcases our culture, which is very important in our society for touristic purpose and to express to the rest of the world our civilization, especially in the Nso land. What with the inspiration from the document, the legacy we have gotten from the image, it showcases our modern culture today to the world, as already mentioned. Possible response, when you look at the document, we have seen a tall and elegant woman clothed in traditional regalia. This traditional heritage has made Nso especially unique, and Cameroon in particular special in the world at large. It's equally a marketing tool to our cultural values, especially for touristic purpose. It's for this reason that Minister of Culture has been put in place to showcase our cultural values that remain rich, and to discard the Eurocentric view that we had no history, we had no civilization. One of the above images has equally stood the test of time to make Cameroon a distinguished country in the world, especially the Nso community. Application exercise two. You observe the document for a minute. We are going to answer the following questions. The first question, identify the personalities in the document. Which value can you learn from the document? And what kind of relationship exists between traditional authorities and the government? This will lead us to possible response to the question above. In the document, we observe the former head of state, Ahmadu Ahidjo, and the Fon Binglo, same of Nso Kingdom. We equally learned the respect for traditional authorities. We should learn to go back to our villages. We pay visit to traditional authorities, and then we get our culture better when we get back to the village and carry out what tradition demands from us. Again, in the document, there is a cordial relationship between the traditional authority and the government. The traditional authorities in Cameroon, especially graded into category A, B, C, work as auxiliary of administration of the state. Again, the funds are regarded as auxiliaries of administration as earlier mentioned. Before we go, we are going to leave you this homework. Trace the origin of pre-colonial matrilineal kingdom of Kong. From the analysis, we took our information from the following sources. First, we have Vigiti Gafansu, Cameroon History for Secondary School and Colleges, Teamwork Press, Bamkekai, Kumbu, 2017. Secondly, www.teachersguides.com, consulted on March 1st, 2021. Third, Botella Eno, Advanced Level History, Pathfinder, Practical MCQs and Easy Questions, Volume 3. The fourth, Tangwe and Others, Cameroon Since 1800, An Advanced Level Approach, second edition, Phoenix Business Studies, Boyer, 2010. Next lesson, in the next class, will be the political, social, and economic organization of the Kong Matrilineal Kingdom. Unategesi matege yob, unatege minga matege nyom, unatege majang matege ndom, manetambia ninyane njubyayen, ngani bana matege mot, ngani lakiri watege ndong, esekina bia dinkido, manetambia ninyane njubyayen, tamtama mote tamzabike, Tam tama tonge tam zabike tam tam tama mote tam zabike mane tambia ninyane njubyayen.